first speaker for today, Prof. Saleh Alaiyan. Dr. Alaiyan is a professor of pediatric at College of Medicine, Al Faisal University, and consultant neonatologist and research scientist in King Faisal Specialist Hospital and Research Center, Riyadh. Dr. Alaiyan will talk about advance in therapy for pulmonary hypertension. Please, Dr. Saleh.
Can you get the slides, please? Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. First, I would like to thank the scientific and organizing committee for inviting me to be a speaker here. And my topic, maybe the title is a bit different from what you have in the scientific program, because I couldn't really talk about just this. The problem, I have too many slides, actually. Why? Because I prepared, you know, my lecture without knowing how many minutes were given to me. But I will take you quickly over most of the important points in this lecture. And I hope that I'll finish on time. I know we are late as well. These are the topics that I will cover them during my talk. And one of the most important things when we talk about PPHN is to have a smooth transition from fetal to extrauterine life. As we know that, I don't know if I have a pointer here, but there is no pointer. I use my finger. I don't know if I can see my finger. Anyway, before birth, as you see here, I mean, the pulmonary blood flow is very low, the pulmonary arterial pressure is high, and the systemic arterial pressure is low. But after birth, because of several, you know, reasons, things will change. Like, you know, the pulmonary blood flow goes higher, and the systemic arterial pressure goes up, pulmonary arterial pressure goes down. Because of clamping of umbilical cord, ventilation of the lungs, and the presence of oxygen, because it is a vasodilator, and also the release of the nitric oxide to increase the production of cyclic GMP and prostaglandin to increase the production of cyclic AMP, besides, you know, the atrial natriuretic peptide, particularly B type, which produces also cyclic GMP and causes pulmonary vasodilation. So if there is any failure of the smooth transition, we get what we call it, the persistent pulmonary hypertension of the newborn. So PPHN is a disease with different underlying etiologies causing persistent elevation of pulmonary vascular resistance. Pathogenesis, of course, I mean, you may see different types of classifications, but I found, you know, classifying them into primary and secondary is much better. Some people like to classify them as functional and organic, and each classification is also subdivided into different, you know, classifications. So the primary, or some people call it idiopathic, can result from several, you know, factors. One of them is the genetic factors. We know that it can enhance also the sensibility of pulmonary arterioles to vasoconstrictive stimuli, or can impair also the mechanism of nitric oxide release and action. And there are some, you know, factors or genes have been identified, like the genes of corticotrophin-releasing hormone receptor with its binding proteins. Maternal medications are very important, especially these medications that can close, you know, the ductus arteriosus, like indomethacin, aspirin, lithium, serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Exposure to chronic hypoxia and underdevelopment of pulmonary vascular bed, as we see in congenital diaphragmatic hernia or alveolar capillary dysplasia. Okay, the secondary, which is very common, can see it in 80 to 90% due to two major factors. One, severe hypoxia. Second, sepsis, particularly the GBS. And this results from the release of some potent vasoconstrictor like leukotrienes, endothelin, free radicals, and thromboxane. Of course, all of these will result in the vicious circle, like pulmonary vasoconstriction, hypoxemia, acidosis, and PPHN. The problem when this is complicated by cardiac dysfunction. These are the potential risk factors. I think we know them. Infection is number one, and also hypoxia and so on. The incidence of PPHN, the overall incidence is around 2 per 1,000 live births. The mortality is ranging from 12 to 29, although in the NINO studies or trial showed lower overall mortality, regardless of the treatment with INO. Okay, diagnosis is very important because many conditions could mimic, you know, PPHN, and like, you know, cyanotic heart disease, but the echocardiogram remains the gold standard diagnostic tool in PPHN. The predictal and postictal, the difference is more than 10. It can be helpful, but it's not diagnostic. So the echo is the most important thing. And in echo, it is important to differentiate or to at least, I mean, confirm the right to left or bidirectional shunting at PFO or PDA, and also the presence of left ventricular dysfunction with pulmonary venous hypertension, because this will help you also in your management or in choosing the vasodilator. BNP is another thing. Some authors think that it can be diagnosed, especially if the level is more than 550 picograms. So the treatment, these are the medications used in treating, you know, babies with PPHN. But before we talk about these medications, there are some general, you know, things that we have to do before we start, you know, the medications. Like, it's important to anticipate the PPHN to prevent it. And one of the things that could be used is antenatal betamethasone. And the most important thing is to send an experienced, you know, team to do the neonatal resuscitation for these babies. Ventilation and hemodynamic support are very important. Reducing the raised pulmonary vascular resistance are very important as well. And this is what we, what I'm going to talk about. That slide, I liked, you know, this diagram. It was published by Sharma in 2015. And it can summarize all, you know, the medications we use. If you see it, I wish if I have a pointer, but go to the right side, see the nitric oxide pathway, and the left side is the prostaglandin pathway. The above one, and the above, you can see the endothelin 1 pathway. So let's just tell you something about the nitric oxide. We all know that, you know, nitric oxide is produced by the endothelial cells, or in the endothelial cells, by the action of the nitric oxide synthase with L-arginine. Nitric oxide, when it is produced, diffuses fast and in large amount to the smooth muscles to activate the soluble guanylate cyclase. And the guanylate cyclase activate the GMP2 cyclic GMP. And this, with the action of the or the presence of calcium, can cause, you know, vasodilatation. There are two things could cause vasoconstriction in that pathway. Number one is the combination of, or the binding of nitric oxide with the oxygen-free radicals. This will result in the peroxide nitride, and this is a very powerful vasoconstrictor. And the other one is the phosphodiesterase, an enzyme that it can break down the cyclic GMP. Of course, we can antagonize the action or inhibit the action of phosphodiesterase by using the sildenafil. On the other side, which is the prostaglandin, we know that prostaglandin is produced by the pathway, the COX or the cyclooxygenase enzymes with the prostaglandin synthase enzymes. And when the prostaglandin is produced, it acts on the receptor, which is the IP here, to activate the adenylate cyclase. And this will result in the production of the cyclic AMP. Of course, cyclic AMP acts the same as the GMP here, and it is also broken down by the phosphodiesterase isomer 3, and this can be prevented or inhibited by the mirinone. The endothelin 1, there are two receptors. One of them is a vasoconstrictor, which is endothelin type A or A, And the other one, which is a vasodilator, because which is the ETB, as you see here in the above one, it's in the endothelial cell. The other one is in the smooth muscles, and it can produce the nitric oxide synthase or increase the production of nitric, and this will lead to nitric oxide. So that summarizes all the medications and the pathways that we can think about. See, these are the treatment: nitric oxide, phosphodiesterase inhibitor, prostaglandin, endothelin receptor antagonist, and I will give you some information about adenosine, magnesium sulfate, ECMO. I'm not going to talk about it, but I listed it in this slide because if you all the medication, all the treatments you've used failed, ECMO is a must. Nitric oxide, respiratory, nitric oxide, there is a review, a systematic review that's published in January 2007, which can summarize, you know, all this, the published, you know, randomized control trials in this regard. This is the objective of the authors or the review to determine whether treatment of hypoxic term and near-term newborn infants with INO improves oxygenation and reduces rate of death and use of ECMO or affects the long-term neurodevelopmental outcomes. It's all randomized trials. And they found 17 randomized controlled studies. 10 of them, they compared INO versus control in infants with moderate or severe severity of illness scores. The one study studied the congenital diaphragmatic hernia, and the other one is INO versus, you know, high frequency ventilation. So the main results of this, you know, INO appears to have improved outcomes in hypoxemic term and near-term infants by reducing the incidence of the combined endpoint of death or use of ECMO, and this was considered as high-quality evidence. The number needed to treat is 5.3. Mortality was not affected. Oxygenation was improved in 50% of babies. Outcomes with the babies with diaphragmatic hernia were not improved. Neurodevelopmental scores, no difference between the two groups. So I'll just take you to the other studies about, you know, the use of nitric oxide in preterm infants. And I'm sure a lot of people are using, you know, nitric oxide in preterm infants. And this is the objectives, is to determine effects of treatment with inhaled nitric oxide on death, BPD, and IVH or other serious brain injury, and then the neurodevelopment. They divided the participants into three groups. Number one, infants treated over the first 3 days of life because of defects in oxygenation. Number two, preterm infants with evidence of pulmonary disease treated routinely with INO. Infants treated later, after the 3 days of age, because of elevated risk of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. These are the main results. Actually, they found like 17 randomized controlled trials. 8 of them showed no significant effect of INO on mortality or BPD. 4 studies showed no significant reduction in the death or BPD. And later treatment with INO based on risk of BPD, there were like 3 trials, revealed no significant benefits and no clear effect on the IVH, although, I mean, they found that early risk treatment was associated with a non-significant 20% increase in severe IVH. This is the conclusion of the authors. INO does not appear to be effective as rescue therapy for the very ill patients. Early routine use of INO in preterm infants with respiratory does not prevent serious brain injury and BPD. And maybe later use of INO to prevent BPD is effective. Okay? Still, even with the treatment that we use, nitric oxide, we have, you know, 40% of babies don't respond to it because of many reasons, listed as you see here. And what we should do with these babies who don't respond to INO? Of course, you may think about adding, you know, other medications like phosphodiesterase inhibitors, and we have 3 types of phosphodiesterase. One is the non-specific, and like, you know, caffeine, theophylline, dipridamol, and we have the specific phosphodiesterase inhibitor for like isomalt 5, which is One of them that I'm sure that commonly uses sildenafil, and the specific phosphodiesterase inhibitor isomer 3, which is the milrinol. Sildenafil, I don't know how many minutes do I have. Am I okay? Huh? 10 minutes? Oh, very good. So I will relax. Okay, so sildenafil for pulmonary hypertension in neonates. And this is a systematic review that was published in 2011. And the objective to assess the efficacy and safety of sildenafil in the treatment of PPHN. These are the selection criteria, as usual. And they found 3 eligible trials that involved 77 infants. And all studies were performed in resource-limited settings where INR and high-frequency ventilation were not available at the time of the study. There was significant reduction in mortality, and the number needed to treat is 3. There was a steady improvement in oxygenation index and PaO2 after the first dose of sildenafil. So the author's conclusion is that sildenafil and the treatment of PPHN has significant potential. What about the use of sildenafil in term and preterm infants? And this is a systematic review. They might have, you know, different opinion about, you know, the use of sildenafil. And here the goal of this study, they was to review control trials evaluating the efficacy of sildenafil in use in 3 groups: term infants with pulmonary hypertension, premature infants at risk for developing BPD, premature infants with BPD-associated pulmonary hypertension. I highlighted this one because it is a real problem. And we have, I think, in our unit, maybe 2 of them. It is a problem. So they find that 5 trials, these 5 trials were randomized controlled trials. 4 of them evaluated the use of sildenafil versus placebo for near-term infants with PPHN. There were no trials of sildenafil in areas in which INO is routinely available. Their findings that all trials or the trials showed improvement in oxygenation index and the reduction in mortality. And more premature infants in the sildenafil group died. No trials evaluated sildenafil versus placebo in premature infants with BPD-associated pulmonary hypertension. So we need more study in this. To pass, so this is the author's conclusion. There is currently little evidence to support the use of sildenafil in term and near-term PPHN. What about the sildenafil treatment of infants with BPD-associated pulmonary hypertension? Actually, we don't have, you know, placebo control studies. All studies were retrospective, and I came up with something that if you have a patient with BPD-associated pulmonary hypertension, I think the best thing, as you see here in the last point, that to do a catheterization for these babies and perform the vasoreactivity test to see which medication is useful for these babies. And I think this is the most important thing, to test for the calcium channel for the sildenafil followed by the bosentan or even other medication. Otherwise, these babies will continue requiring, you know, oxygen or even other vasodilator. Mirinone. I'm sure a lot of people are using, you know, mirinone in their units. We use it as well. And I found this systematic review. And this is the objectives of their study, to assess efficacy and safety in infants with PPHN, either treated with the following here. And the authors found no studies meeting the criteria for inclusion in this review. I wish if they invited me to join them in this review, because they didn't. I think they didn't really do a lot of things to do. I mean, no analysis. So the efficacy and safety of mirinone are not known. We need more RCT or randomized controlled studies on this regard. There are several pilot studies just to check, you know, the safety, clearance, also the the effect on oxygenation, and so this study showed that yes, those who received enomeranone have better oxygenation. Posentan, and they found this systemic also review on this, and the objective is to assess the efficacy and safety of posentan. There were like two randomized control trials. The first one was done in a setting where inhaled nitric oxide is not available, and the second one was a multi-center trial. And actually, the first one, they found no significant difference in the incidence of death before hospital discharge. And a higher proportion of infants in the bosentan group showed improvement in oxygenation, but the study suffered from a high risk of attrition bias. And the other one showed no significant difference between in the incidence of treatment failure, needing ECMO between the INO plus bosentan versus INO plus placebo. So until now, the quality of evidence was considered low. The conclusion of the authors, there's inadequate evidence to support the use of bosentan. Prostaglandin, of course, I know some people are using, you know, prostaglandin. And the drug that a lot of people are using it nowadays is the olaprost, nebulized. By the way, none of them are approved for the treatment of PPHN. And olaprost, we know that used alone in case reports and retrospective chart reviews. We don't have randomized controlled trials. And of course, most of the studies showed improvement in the oxygenation. The oral sildenafil and inhaled iloprost, and this study showed that, you know, iloprost, the oxygenation in the group, in the iloprost group, is much better than the sildenafil. Adenosine infusion for PPHN, still, I mean, we have limited, you know, studies on this regard, but it seems to be encouraging. It seems to be that it could really help because it has a rapid onset of action. When you have a baby who's really hypoxic, you may use, you know, adenosine, and it can be, but we need, it can help in babies with PPHN, but we need more studies in this regard. Calcium channel blockers, there's no evidence to use CCBs to treat, you know, PPHN. And magnesium sulfate, we don't have actually randomized controlled trials, but all the reports showed that the use of magnesium sulfate cannot be, you know, recommended. I'm sure that a lot of people are using magnesium sulfate nowadays, but there are also some complications for it. Magnesium sulfate and sildenafil showed clearly that sildenafil was more effective than magnesium sulfate. I put dipridamol because I tried to do dipridamol a long time ago. This is in the 90s. Plus, you know, adding L-arginine, I still believe in an L-arginine is important to treat, you know, PPHN in order to produce also nitric oxide. And this report showed that, yes, they are very helpful. Now we have to replace with this non-specific phosphodiesterase inhibitor with the sildenafil. And steroids in PPHN seems to be helpful, but we need, you know, clinical studies. All the studies here are preclinical. And what's the future in the therapy of PPHN? I listed the five of them. Enhancers of nitric oxide activity, and there are several, you know, medications available. Direct soluble guanylate cyclase activators, prostacyclin analogs, and I talked about the oloprost, and there are also others could be used. RHI kinase inhibitors, and antioxidants. So all of these could be used for the future. I mean, could be tested to treat, you know, PPHN. The last thing is the mesenchymal stem cells and the endothelial progenitor cells. And this is seems to be also very important, but still we are we don't have like clinical, you know, studies. All the studies published were preclinical, and it showed that, you know, the bone marrow-derived MSCs was capable of regenerating lung vascular and alveolar growth and reversing associated pulmonary hypertension. The same thing was obtained in BPD models that, you know, UCB derived FEC can do the same thing, can regenerate lung, you know, vascular and anaerobic growth. So my conclusion, your main goal should be to restore the cardiopulmonary adaptation without inflicting an iatrogenic pulmonary injury, prevent and anticipate PPHN, immediate ventilator and hemodynamic support, treat the underlying etiology, confirm the diagnosis, start high frequency ventilation and INO if available. If you have INO, sometimes some people don't use it because they don't have the delivery system. In our hospital, we don't have any of the delivery system. We used to have the Pulmonox, but nowadays we use this equation that we published it, I think, a few years ago, and seems to be very helpful, and we didn't see any complications of this. And I think this is my last slide. Yes, and thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Prof. Saleh.